Welcome once more. We have a few people joining in. We're talking today about the Canadian Certified Inclusion Professional Certification. We have an open house here where you'll be able to ask your questions and learn more about the certification program. I do want to start today by honoring the land from which we are joining together. This webinar is brought to you through the modern magic of the internet, but we are nevertheless situated on lands that are old and storied, and it's important for us to acknowledge this. It's a way to also root our presentation in the land and the historical context and present context that we live in. So I would like to acknowledge that I'm joining you today from the unceded territory of the Wolastoqiyik and Mi'kmaq peoples in what is known today as Moncton, New Brunswick. I also want to invite our panelists to share their statement of land acknowledgement. So, Andrea, would you like to add your statement?
Thank you so much. I'm coming to you from Coast Salish territories where I live, work, and play as an uninvited settler. And those I live in a place now known as Victoria, and that's home to the Songhees, Esquimalt, and Wasunich Nations. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Andrea. Heidi, would you like to share your statement as well?
Yes, thank you. I'm privileged to be on the territory, traditional unceded territory of the Algonquin and Anishinaabe Nation, a land that is now known as Ottawa, Ontario.
Thank you so much, Heidi. And now, Valerie, would you like to share your statement?
Thank you, Miriam. It is a privilege to live and work on the original lands of Anishinaabe, Cree, Oji-Cree, Dakota, and Dene peoples, and on the homeland of the Red River Métis, Winnipeg, Manitoba. As a Black woman whose African ancestors were enslaved and whose blood was shed to help build this nation, I am committed to forming alliances and solidarity with Indigenous peoples in our collective commitment to make the promise and the challenge of truth and reconciliation real in our communities. I am responsible to learn, unveil the truth, and personally commit myself to reconciliation. I will engage in uncomfortable conversations, examine my own privilege and bias. I will continuously examine policies, procedures, and conduct in our work and learning environment to identify and dismantle those structures in which racism and oppression continue to be embedded. Acknowledging the land is only one small step towards reconciliation.
Thank you so much, Valerie. A beautiful statement. Indeed, we all have a role to play in truth and reconciliation, and we all should continue to educate ourselves about Indigenous causes, past and present. Thank you so much for all your land acknowledgements. I'll take a moment to introduce myself. My name is Miriam Chasson. My pronouns are she, her. En français, elle, avec les accords grammaticaux féminins. I'm a manager and team lead of Learning and Knowledge Solutions. I am also in charge of the CCIP program. So when you email the CCIP email address or send in any sort of applications, I will be the one receiving them. So I'm happy to be here today to teach you more about the CCIP program. Finally, I've been part of the CCDI family since 2021. Now, I'd also like to give an opportunity to our panelists to introduce themselves. Andrea, would you like to start us off?
Thanks so much, Miriam. My name is Andrea Carey. I use the pronouns she, her, hers, and elle, and I identify as a white cisgender woman. I'm parent to an 11-year-old little human who's on her own adventures of figuring out who she is. As I mentioned, I live as an uninvited settler on Coast Salish territory, and I grew up as an uninvited settler on Tanajah territories in the East Kootenays of British Columbia. I identify as non-disabled, neurotypical, and I am a brain tumor survivor and had episodic disability related to that experience. And I run a diversity and inclusion company called Inclusion Incorporated.
Thank you so much, Andrea. Heidi, would you like to introduce yourself?
Yes, absolutely. Hello to everyone joining us today from wherever you are joining us across Canada. I've had the pleasure of being an HR executive, and I have over 20 years of working experience now, as well as having my CCIP. I'm also very fortunate to have my certified HR executive certification. I'm also a chartered professional in human resources, and I'm a certified coach practitioner. I'm a big believer in giving back to the community, and as a volunteer, I sit on a number of organizations, including being a board member of our Children's Hospital of Eastern Ontario, part of the Employers Council Champion for an organization here in Ottawa called Hire Immigrants Ottawa, supporting new Canadians coming into Ottawa to integrate into the community and find work that is meaningful and representative of the work that they've done in previous roles. And I also support our college, Algonquin College, as well as being a mentor with a variety of different organizations, including a new mentorship role that I've taken on with the Coalition of Innovation Leaders Against Racism, also known as CELAR.
Thank you very much, Heidi. I see Marnie has joined us. Would you like to introduce yourself?
So thanks, everybody. I'm Marnie Panis. I am grateful to be here. I use she and her pronouns. I would like to do my territory acknowledgement, if I could, please. I come from Treaty 6 territory, which is in Edmonton, and also the Métis homelands of the Métis Nation of Alberta and Region 4. The Cree called this territory Amaskawiskawaskahagan, which is Beaver Hills House. The Nakota Sioux call it Teota, which is many houses. And the Nitsipani call it Amakwesis, or Big Lodge. So I'm grateful to be on this territory and working with so many people to really improve the experiences for everybody who calls this place home, where we work, live, and play. So I join you today. I am the senior manager for diversity, equity, inclusion with ATCO. I joined ATCO in April to move their help move the work DEI work forward. And prior to that, I worked with Alberta Health Services, leading diversity, equity, and inclusion at Alberta Health Services for a number of years, and really starting it from when there really wasn't a DEI at Alberta Health Services. Prior to that, I love that see that Heidi's connection to the Children's Hospital. I started my work as a family-centered care coordinator at the Stollery Children's Hospital about 12, 13 years ago, after the birth of my twin boys and the death of one of them. And my work way back then was including, really creating a space where everybody can bring their whole selves to their healthcare experience, that set of patients and families of all backgrounds can participate in their healthcare experience, whether it's at the bedside, in the boardroom, in the operations of a hospital, and in a healthcare system. And I think back to, just because my title wasn't diversity, equity, and inclusion back then, our work has always been about being equitable and creating an inclusive space. So when I think about our profession and this work, is to really expand past our own titles and think of all the work that we've done in our many, boards and participation, and the different work that we've done has all led to equitable and inclusive services for the people and the communities that we find ourselves in. And so that's my first challenge of you folks looking at this profession, is to think beyond the title. There's just so much that we've been doing over, in our lives that have led us to this place. And that's where I find myself today. I happen to also be the chair of the board of the CCDI. I'm very proud to be involved with the board at this level and to really help guide and nurture and support this amazing organization going forward. So, and among the first cohort of CCIP, a very proud CCIP from the very first cohort all these years ago. It feels like a little bit older than I'd like to admit to these days, but I'm just really proud of this profession and this designation. And if you look for any positions that I'm posting for, it's always looking for a CCIP. So that's something to think about. All right, I'm going to hand it back to Miriam, please.
Thank you, Marnie. Valerie, would you like to introduce yourself?
Yes, thank you so much, Miriam. I am Valerie Williams, Black Canadian cisgender woman, born and raised on Treaty 1 territory. My pronouns are she and her. I serve as the director in the Office of Equity, Access, and Participation, Rady Faculty of Health Sciences, University of Manitoba. Our strategy is grounded in social justice, human rights, equity, access, and participation. And my primary goal, and I'm really sincere, and I think this is the focus of the office, is to identify and dismantle the structures in which oppression and discrimination in all forms are embedded in our organizations. Prior to my role at Rady Faculty, I worked at the University of Manitoba Human Resources as a diversity consultant for about 11 years, and that was awesome. But prior to that, when I first start getting involved in this work, I worked at a private consulting engineering firm. I have my CPHR and I was in human resources, and I managed the employment equity program, which was really a pathway to the work I do today. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Valerie. So we're going to hear some more from our panelists a little later on. You're going to have a chance, also participants, to ask them questions. Before that, however, I will do a brief overview of the CCIP certification programs. Then again, we're going to hear from our panelists, and then we'll have a question period. So let's start with an overview of the CCIP program. So the field of diversity, equity, and inclusion is relatively new, and it has changed a lot over the years, and it continues to evolve. And before the Canadian Certified Inclusion Professional Certification launched in 2017, there was no designation for DEI professionals in Canada. So the CCIP certification intends to provide a standardized way to recognize the knowledge and skills of DEI professionals. So therefore, it helps to assure employers, clients, organizations, and other professionals that a DEI practitioner meets a rigorous set of standards, namely the CCIP competency framework. The CCIP competency framework has 13 competencies. So to be clear, the CCIP certification is a professional designation, not an educational program. So there's no training element to this program. We expect candidates to already be experienced professionals. So in a way, the CCIP certification is a little bit like a seal of approval from CCDI, an organization recognized as a leader in the Canadian DEI space for professionals who have completed the CCIP process and demonstrated their knowledge and skills. Well, since the launch of the CCIP certification in 2017, there have been 10 completed cycles. And as of August 31st, 2023, there are 158 CCIP certification holders in good standing. So before I continue describing the program, I just wanted to share some documents that prospective applicants should read in detail. So on the CCIP website, in the related documents section at the bottom, you'll find the certification handbook, and it details the certification process, and beyond in detail. You'll find the CCIP competency framework there on which the exam is based, and there's also an eligibility checklist. That's a tool for potential applicants to determine if they have the qualifications to apply. So it's only for your own information. There's also an FAQ page online with a lot of important information. Applicants are expected to familiarize themselves with the program as part of the application process. My colleague has shared a number of links in the chat for you if you'd like to go bookmark some of those for your later reading pleasure. Also, there are two main criteria to be eligible to apply to the CCIP certification program. First, applicants must have at least 3 years full-time DEI experience or the equivalent. This experience must be from a Canadian setting because CCDI's mandate is a Canadian one, and we are not experts in international DEI practice. Volunteer experience is applicable for this criteria. Also, part-time experience can be claimed at a rate of 1 week of full-time experience for every 35 hours of work. Also, applicants should have at least 2 years recent DEI experience, we mean within the last 6 years, as part of their three-year requirement. Also, applicants need at least two professional references. They can be colleagues, supervisors, clients. To avoid a conflict of interest, though, references should not be direct reports, so employees that you supervise, and they should not be relatives of the applicant. These references should be able to speak to the candidate's DEI experience. Also, there is a registration fee. It is due at the time of application. Candidates can also purchase access to an optional study guide, and that remains accessible until the day before the exam. There are discounts available to employees of employer partners and individual practitioners. These are individual CCDI partners that are kind of like employer partners, but just at the individual level. Certification process starts with the application. Registration for an upcoming exam opens about 4 weeks after the previous exam and closes 6 weeks before. So there's about 4.5 month period during which someone can register for the upcoming exam. There's a form to fill on our website. It asks for some personal information and for payment, and it requires two uploaded documents, namely the assessment of eligibility form and a resume. The assessment of eligibility form includes spaces to list your DEI-related roles, describe these roles, indicate which areas of competency were developed during these roles, and it's also where candidates will list their references. The form is also available in the related documents section on the main CCIP page, and it's also in the chat. We also require a resume tailored to the CCIP process. This document allows candidates to provide a more holistic vision of their work experience, including community involvement, speaking engagements, volunteering experience, etc. After registration, there's a decision that is communicated to applicants one way or another. For those who are accepted into the program, all candidates receive a reading list to help prepare for the exam. Those who purchased access to the optional study guide will receive their credentials to log into the platform. Additionally, candidates should study the CCIP competency framework that's available on our website. There are two exams a year, one in the spring and one in the fall. The upcoming exams are on April 16th, 2024. Registration for that exam opens next week, November 14th, 2023. And there's another exam in the fall on October 22nd, 2024. The online exam consists of 100 multiple choice questions. Candidates are allowed 3 hours to complete the exam. The day of the exam, the exam is open from 8 a.m. Eastern to 7 p.m. Eastern. You can start at any time, and that's when your 3 hour timer starts, essentially. So you got to finish it within 3 hours after your starting time. Candidates receive their exam results immediately after completing the exam. After completing the exam, candidates can start working on the professional experience dossier. The PED is a collection of essays that demonstrate the candidate's competence in the 12 competency areas. Candidates are asked to describe a situation where they put the competency area in action. Candidates must receive a minimum score to pass. Candidates can provide essays for all areas of competency if they wish. This increases an opportunity to score more points. It's recommended to submit at least 7 essays. The PED is due about 8 weeks after the exam. As part of the evaluation process, PEDs are sent out to external assessors selected by the candidate. Candidates are required, therefore, to identify one main external assessor and an alternate. External assessors should be familiar with the candidate's DEI work, and they can, in fact, be the same people that you selected as professional references at the time of registration. Following the evaluation by the CCIP manager and by the external assessor, candidates who meet the passing score are officially certified. After completing the program, CCIP recipients can use the CCIP acronym in their signature, for example, in their email or on their LinkedIn profile, in their resume, etc. CCIP recipients are also added to the online registry of CCIP holders. The registry is available on the CCI website, and it lists all CCIP holders, their location, their employer, their title, and a link to their LinkedIn page. It's possible to opt out of the registry or to omit some of the fields, like not sharing your location, for example. That's up to you. Finally, to maintain the certification, CCIP holders are expected to submit a log of continued professional development, including 20 hours of activities by December 31st every year. And there is a submission fee associated with this requirement. CCIP holders work throughout Canada in a variety of sectors and industries and in different capacities. CCIP holders are subject matter experts and promote inclusion within organizations with strategic support and initiatives addressing issues around diversity, equity, and human rights in the workplace that impact organizations, customers, members, and communities. If you have any questions about the logistics, you are welcome to ask them during the Q&A part. I will be the one answering them. Now, I do want to turn over to our panelists, all CCIAP holders. I'd like them to share their experience and how the certification has supported their career and professional development. So I'm going to stop sharing my screen so it's a little bit more intimate. Stop sharing. There we go. Andrea, would you like to start us off?
Yeah, thanks, Mariam. My CCIP journey began, I'd heard about the certification, but I was actually at a presentation in, I guess, kind of winter 2019. And the presenter identified that she held CCIP. And I was like, oh, okay. And she was talking about some really amazing things, obviously a super cool human, and I had an amazing role. And I was at a point of kind of metamorphosis in terms of what I wanted to do next. And so I looked into it and recognized that I had the depth of experience that was required to apply for it. And then went through the process of applying to take the exam. I did purchase the study guide, which was incredibly supportive in terms of a large volume of information over a very short period of time to study for the exam. So I found that a really supportive resource. And I think my biggest insight from going through that process was, one, recognizing the number of areas I'd worked in across my career, because I felt like I'd held DEI connected roles across my whole career, but it hadn't really been, there hadn't been an opportunity to sort of summarize that and think through that in a thoughtful way. So it was an opportunity to kind of culminate that, but also to recognize some areas where I needed to build and grow my understanding and learning. So it was a really cool process to go through from a few perspectives. And I was grateful to be successful and to continue to go through that renewal every year is also a good reminder of just making sure that you're staying current. I work in the space every day, started a consultancy firm called Inclusion Incorporated shortly after I got my CCIP, and now lead a group of staff and contractors across the country working across a range of sectors. And I lean for sure on the learnings of CCIP as we do that work, and also in how I support our team as we go forward. So it's been a really incredible opportunity to be part of a community as well. And I've met so many people since I've gotten it where we're connected because we both have it and the LinkedIn group's really helpful. So it's just, yeah, it has been a really supportive piece for me.
Wonderful, Andrea. Thanks so much for sharing. Next, I'd like to hear from Heidi.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Mariam. You know, a similar journey, you know, I think, you know, very much throughout my career in a role of leading HR teams for companies, both in the nonprofit sector as well as the technology sector, you know, creating an environment which is welcoming to everyone, where everyone can bring their authentic selves to work and do their best work, has definitely always been not only a passion of mine, but also a responsibility that I take really seriously. And I'm, you know, definitely have a growth mindset, always eager to develop my knowledge. And so when I was pursuing some other studies in EDI, I saw that the CIP was really building momentum, and I started to lean in and get more information about it. And I would say that, you know, I also felt like it was, you know, growth both personally and professionally. I think, Andrea, you mentioned that too. And I think that was my biggest takeaway, was how much I learned and grew through the study and the work experience I had gained up until doing the certification. And then, you know, kind of reaffirming how important it is to continue. As you said, Mariam, at the start, it's ever evolving. This work is always changing. And I felt like the community coming together to develop this certification, one, you know, demonstrates how important this work is, and the people that are doing this work. I think highlighting that is really, really clear. I think it furthered my commitment, you know, in fostering an inclusive and diverse work environment in the companies that I'm working with. I think that it helped me gain a deeper understanding of diversity, equity, and inclusion, really helped, you know, confirm the skills that create an inclusive environment. I think it's been a game changer for me personally. Again, I do a lot of work as a volunteer, supporting individuals who have different abilities and helping to, learn from their lived experience and couple that with the experience and knowledge that, I got leading up to the CCIP. And I know that while it's not a course, that study guide was really important because I think it brings it all sort of home, if I could say that, in terms of acknowledging the really important skills and knowledge that you likely all have on this call. And you may be wondering, am I ready to take, to take that next step and to try to obtain the CCIP? And I would say, yes, go for it. I think that taking the step to even go through the application process to see what experience you do have, and even maybe identifying the potential gaps in your experience to date or your learning to date will help you identify other areas where you can grow personally and professionally. And it certainly did for me. I kind of felt like it was almost like a roadmap of, here are the things that I want to achieve and how I want to support my team, and the companies that I support around me. So for me, it was, a bit of a roadmap on and how to do that successfully. So it was a fabulous experience. And again, I learned, I think that the big moment for me was a lot of personal growth on top of the professional growth. And that was something that I didn't expect, but I really, really appreciated about the entire experience.
Thank you so much, Heidi. I'm glad you had a good experience. Marnie, I'd love to hear from you.
Great. Just a lot of similar experiences. I was in the first cohort and I was kind of the test pilots and going through the testing. And it was, so I actually took advantage of it because we had a bit of a break in things in case things went wonky, but they didn't go wonky. It was a pretty great process, actually. I came from a world of healthcare. And if you think about Alberta Health Services at the time, at least up until today, I think I heard the news that they're kind of separating it into a whole bunch of parts. But up until today, Canada's fourth largest employer, 130,000 people, and largest healthcare system in the province. And so leading that was quite daunting, of course, the DEI work. And in healthcare, or, folks who might come from academia and those other places, professional designations are really powerful and necessary for not only for advancement, but for credibility and integrity and to be seen amongst others that are in the group, right? I didn't have my HR designation and nor was it something that I was pursuing because I see DEI being something that transcends HR. It's about safe and inclusive environments, not just an HR function. And so that's always been something that's been important to me. And so so that's why an HR designation was never really something that I aspired to, but this was something that really spoke to all those experiences. As I said earlier on, that I had years of family centered care coordinator at the Stollery, which were all DEI activities. It looked different. It wasn't HR, it was about patient experience, but it really helped improve how everybody shows up in the healthcare system. And I took those same principles into my work into a DEI professional and into this profession. It's about creating safe and inclusive environments. It's one thing to tell healthcare providers to provide safe and inclusive care. It's another to actually impact the systems and the tools that they have to provide that safe and inclusive care, recognizing that impacts patients and families. So that was really important to me right from day one. And so the academics and the having a designation was really essential. And this is certainly something that aligned with my own personal values and beliefs and where I was in my own career at the time. A couple of other things that I think about in this work is I'm on in the media quite often, and whether I'm in, if I could be on the BBC or CNN or national news, doing a lot of work on government legislation and policy and so forth. And when I'm in the media, being able to, when they ask what your tagline is, I'm not an advocate, I'm not an activist, I'm a Canadian certified inclusion professional. And that gives a different sense of, again, integrity and just ups the game in qualifications and a different level of respect. And I think just that it acknowledges the skills that we already have and the professionalism that we all come to this work in. It sets us apart from people. Anybody can call themselves a DEI person, but this acknowledges the specific skills and expertise that we all bring to this work, and it elevates that work in different ways. So even within media, it lends to a certain integrity that I didn't have, before myself, I had integrity, but integrity to the profession that we bring. And that was really, really important. And in my role as a leader, you know, and I'm seeing that a lot in a lot of roles where, you know, I've seen advertising for DEI professionals are looking for that CCIP as an example of a professional designation. And that's really important. That's what I was looking for. That's what I'm looking for. And I'm just proud to say that, you know, we're hiring, you know, I just wrapped up recruitment and hired another CCIP to join me at ATCO. And I'm really excited to have her join me. And so that was intentional. And we had, you know, three of the six that were interviewed were CCIPs. And so that's really exciting. So, you know, that's an opportunity that, again, that I can bring into this role, that there's a certain level of professionalism that people already bring. And that's what this acknowledges. And I appreciate what Heidi had said earlier when I do a lot of mentorship and coaching. I've been a person to sign off on people's documents and provide those references in my work, because the way that our network works, it's small, but we start to get to know each other across Canada, which is really exciting, building that network and that connection amongst people. What I look at when we look at the competencies that are displayed there, it provides not, you know, a really great roadmap, as Heidi said, but also, you know, identifies where are your own gaps of learning and understanding to be a really fully formed CCIP professional. We recognize that it's not about any one group, any one people, you know, group people that we're advocating for or working towards. It's about creating a safe and inclusive environment for everybody. Looking at the competencies allows us to identify our own gaps in knowledge and understanding that we can focus our own attention on. So it's a really great tool that I look at when I'm mentoring people to start there. Even if they're a year or two away from having all of the years that they need to be a CCIP, it's a great place to start now, so that you can start building towards your competencies and your own gaps, and as that roadmap is to lead you to that designation. So that's where I bring it in, and it's just something I'm very proud of. And that's why I'm still here and on the advisory group all these years later, because it's something that I think our profession needs and deserves.
Thank you so much, Marnie. Very inspirational. Let's hear from Valerie now.
Thank you so much, Miriam. This panel has really inspired me. Thank you so much for including me in this conversation. My commitment to the cause of equity has been a driving force in my work. And Miriam, you had mentioned subject matter expert. And I can remember when I worked at the engineering firm in human resources managing the employment equity program, I had a performance review with my manager at the time. And she said, "What are your goals?" I said, "I want to be a subject matter expert in equity." And that was around 2008. So here it is, 2023. And I'm really thankful I've reached some of my goals. It was a few years ago, I had the honor of meeting Michael Bach, the former CEO of CCDI, in a workshop in Vancouver. In our conversation, I expressed my keen interest, and I was, you know, encouraging him. CCDI should facilitate a designation in EDI. I was doing the research, and there was a lot of opportunities in the United States, but I really wanted the Canadian perspective. And Michael assured me at that time that CCDI was working on this program. And every few months, I would email him asking him, "Are you there yet?" So in 2016, I enrolled in the Leadership and Inclusion course at Centennial College and became part of the first cohort, like Marnie, that wrote the exam in 2017 and attained my designation in 2018. I'm sure we've all noticed the increase of EDI practitioners, within our organizations. And it's undoubtedly a very positive trend. However, in conversation with many people, I notice that we're not always using the most respectful language. And there's no blame, we're all at different stages. However, I believe it's really important and words matter. Diversity and inclusion don't happen by themselves. Both take time, effort, and focus. And it is the role of the EDI practitioner to convince others of the value of diversity and inclusion and convince others to make the necessary changes to make that happen. And that is what the CCIP designation has given me, an awareness of the constantly evolving language and the best practices. I have the privilege of developing relationships with other CCIPs, and everyone enriches my work. And I take advantage of so many great resources CCDI offers. And I use those resources to develop my strategy, inform my work, and create workshops. I work in a university, and as Marty said, it's really important that I have credibility and integrity that the CCIP designation gives me. I can't underestimate the need for EDI practitioners to develop a network of diverse voices. All of us need diverse perspectives to inform our initiatives. This is really hard work. It is really rewarding work, but it's hard and the progress is slow. And we need to take the time to celebrate every step we take. And for me, achieving my CCIP designation was huge. I studied hard. I learned so much. And believe this designation has allowed me to move forward in my career and move me ahead on the equity continuum. No one has arrived in equity, and we're all at different places, and we're all going to make mistakes, and that is okay. But what I don't know, I get to learn from the amazing people in my circle, other CCIPs, and CCDI. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Valerie. I really appreciate hearing from all of you. It's great to see, you know, the importance of the work that we're doing here. So now we're going to move into the Q&A portion of our session. I will note that we're getting a lot of comments and a lot of questions. I've been trying to sort through some of the more logistic parts. I do want to mention, if we don't get to your question, I apologize in advance. You can always send an email to ccip.certification@ccdi.ca. I'll share the address again at the end. So I'm seeing some questions, like I mentioned, related to logistics, and there's a couple I'd like to address. First, I'm getting questions about, do I need DEI in my title for it to count as DEI experience? Wonderful question, and the short answer is no. What I wanna see is the skills and competencies that are detailed in the competency framework being present as part of the things that you do every day. I think we mentioned even in our panel that some people didn't have that in their title because the departments were growing and things were changing, and that's part of our work too. So not at all for experience to count, you don't necessarily need that in the title. Thank you for that. There were a lot of good questions. Sorry about that. There was a question also about that 3 years of experience. I did want to mention, I don't need to see like a breakdown. You don't need to like do a math equation to show me the total, you know, if there's part-time or only part of your work is DEI, et cetera. You can always apply. And if for whatever reason I need more information or there's a little something missing, the program is pretty forgiving. We do a full refund if unfortunately you're not selected. What I'm trying to say here is I don't need a full breakdown. If you're not sure, we can take a look that 3 years. I've seen many different ways that people apply and meet that criteria and exceed it even. So please don't worry if it's not like super clear cut how you meet that 3 years. There's a lot of different ways to meet that criteria. I also see questions around holding other professionals designation. There's in the FAQ, there's a question around that. All that means is like, you can have more than one designation. There's not necessarily a link between CCIP and other designations. Like it might not necessarily like help you get the CCIP. What we're really looking for is that professional experience. It's trying to say like you can have more than one acronym after your name, essentially. Okay, I think that's a good start for our more logistics question. Keep them coming. Is there access to the study guide without registering first? No, the study guide does need to be purchased. It's optional, and it will be sent after registration and being accepted into the program. All right. Now, I'd love to hear a little bit more from the panelists about their experience with the exam. How did you prepare? Do you have any tips for the exam? If you want to chime into that, you can kind of give me a wave. I'll be happy to pass you the mic. Valerie, how about you start us off, Valerie, and then we'll go to Marnie. Thank you.
I studied my butt off. And at that time, Marnie, was there a guide? I'm sure I purchased it. I don't remember if we had a guide then.
No, there wasn't. I don't recall there being a guide, but I do remember the competencies was listed into like the 10 or 13 different competencies. And they had a lot of reading materials that they sent along with it and that fit. And some of them, the reading materials fit, you know, three or four of the competencies. Some, you know, just the Employment Equity Act, for example, was quite different and it just stood on its own. So I remember reading all of those things, all of the links, and that's what I studied using the competencies. And that was really helpful.
It was really helpful. So it was a lot of work, but I learned so much. You know, it was joy for me. I'm glad I don't have to do it again, but it certainly helped me. And it improved my work. It improved the strategies that I was able to create and the initiatives that I developed.
I would agree with that. And so for me, you know, so described how I learned at the time. And again, we were new into it. So we were kind of figuring out how to prepare for it. The exam itself was pretty straightforward. I think it was 100 questions and they were reasonable questions. Like, and it really tested the pieces that were in the competence. I thought they're really great that way. But you're right, Valerie, it helped me identify even my own gaps. And in itself, I became a more well-rounded CCIP professional, because we all come into our work for different ways. You know, I love the language that you used. That's, you know, we weren't born equitable. We came into this place often experiencing our own experiences of oppression and barriers that we've had to work through. And so, you know, none of us just choose DEI going into college. It's something we've had to because of our own survival often. And so it's become part of who we are. And so sometimes that we could also be very, you know, a little bit more limited or narrow in our approaches because we've had to be. That's where we've been focusing our energies on. For me, it was in healthcare, or maybe we're focused on gender equality, or maybe we're focused on anti-racism. What this allowed me to do was really identify the areas that I needed to, create more exposure for myself and more understanding and learning so I could truly be a more rounded DEI professional, so that, you know, we're there to create inclusive spaces for everybody that our workplace interacts with. All the people, even the people who are in the dominant group, have, you know, that, you know, everybody benefits from this work. So that's where that set of competencies helped me in my studies.
I love that the CCIP give you your results right away. I think, you know, when you've done other certifications, you'll know that you have to wait for that letter in the mail or that email that comes forward, and having that immediate, you know, feedback, I think was really great. I think, you know, having it's an inclusive opportunity, right, to be able to do the exam from your home or wherever you choose to do it, and creating that environment where you have the time dedicated, like, specifically to.
Heidi, you're on mute. I don't know what happened there. Is that right, Heidi? Oh. Andrea, did you want to share your ideas here? We'll come back to Heidi when the technology is nicer to her.
Yeah, I do have to say I'm really grateful that the study guide got created, because that was when I got the reading list. I just remember being like, oh my gosh, I don't know how I can possibly read all these resources. So kudos to Valerie and Marnie for leading the way and probably giving some feedback that it was a bit overwhelming, because the study guide really, as I said in my earlier piece, was really kind of a saving grace for me in terms of it allowed me to really focus in on the competencies and what I needed to know for the exam, and provided, I'm going to say, a summary probably of many of the resources that are on the reading list. So that was extraordinarily helpful for me. And I agree with Heidi that the instantaneous results was like, okay, now I can focus on building out that kind of resume piece to really answer more in depth how I show up in each of the competencies.
Thanks, Andrea. Yeah, you get a pass or fail immediately. And then if you want more information about your results, but it's nice to get to, like, I can breathe now. And I did want to mention quickly the study guide. There is an extra fee for it. And I just want to mention, I've seen plenty of people do fabulously well on the exam without the study guide. It might be more in terms of your studying style, things like that. So I don't want to, like, scare people if unfortunately they can't get access to the study guide. Let's go back to Heidi. hopefully.
Yes, I apologize.
No.
But another good point to make sure that, you know, your technology is working when you're doing your exam. Things that I think I was thinking about was I really made sure the day of the exam that I was in a really good mindset, right? And took the time to have some mindfulness and really be present and recognizing kind of the journey up until that point. And also acknowledged, regardless of the results, you can do it again. Right, Marnie and Andrea, you know, I think Valerie, if you're not successful that first time, don't be deterred to not try again. Not everyone, I'm sure, was successful the first time. And that doesn't mean that your experience, that you're not doing incredible work and that you're not moving things forward. It just may mean that you need to put a little bit more emphasis on your studying the next time, give yourself a little bit more exposure experience to some other of the core competencies. And I encourage you to try again. There is that saying, right? If not at first succeed, try again. And in that case, I think for this too, some folks struggle with doing the exam. So if they get a lot of anxiety and they really work themselves up right before. And so when I'm focusing more on kind of preparing yourself for that. I think, you know how best you kind of retain knowledge and experience and sort of, you know, take the time you need to do that and then go into that exam knowing that you're going to do your very best. And if for some reason you're not successful, make sure that you put it as a goal to kind of try again, because I think it is such an important certification to kind of validate all the experience and exposure and experience and skills that you have, that it's important to put in the additional effort if you need to.
Thanks, Heidi. I did want to acknowledge Valerie had to leave. Many thanks to Valerie for participating today. I do want to acknowledge another question here. Is the program offered in French? Yes. 100%. Fortunately, we weren't able to have a separate open house at this time. Hopefully in the future, everything is available in French. The exam, you can do the PD in French. Everything is in French. I speak French. I can answer your questions in French as well. Thank you for the opportunity to clarify that. excuse me. I'd love to hear a little bit from Andrea also about kind of starting your own firm. How did the CCIP support you there?
Thanks, Mariam. I think for me, as I said it, when I took the exam and kind of recognized that CCIP was an option for moving that area of work forward, I'd already determined that that was really the area I was passionate about in my career and I wanted to invest more intentionally in. And I was in a situation where I couldn't do the work in ways that ascribed to the values that I believed we needed to bring to the work. We were kind of working in silos, not looking at intersectionality. And so CCIP, as I said earlier, really supported me to just sort of tie together the knowledge I had, understand the gaps I had, and kind of build out, like, what's the vision of this? Where do we want to take this? How do we do this work in really good and meaningful ways? Knowing it's long-term work and we need organizations and leaders to really invest in it. And so through that process and kind of recognizing the ways we needed to approach the work and leaning on the competencies to kind of build out my understanding, but also what I believed a company should then be able to offer clients, it allowed us to build a consultancy that really digs into a number of the competencies and sort of how we bring those to life with our clients and creating that curiosity, that growth mindset, that support, that empathy, and that engagement around this topic area. And so we're almost 4 years old, and we've got 6.5 staff now and about 20 contractors working across the country. We work in a range of different sectors, and I'm just really grateful both for the incredible people we work with every day and the clients that put their trust in us. And CCIP has been an important part of that journey. So thank you.
Thank you, Andrea, for sharing that. I see one more question here for any of the panelists that'd like to answer. What was the most challenging part of the process for you? Anybody would like to chime into that?
Well, again, this seems so long ago, but I love seeing, I think the challenging process, I did not get my results right away. And so that's nice to see that movement. We had to wait because, again, we were the first kind of testing the testing system and the whole bit. So that was all very new. And so the waiting was a little bit of a challenge. So I'm thrilled that that's been resolved. Yeah, and I appreciate that. And honestly, I took it because I think because we were the first cohort, if we didn't pass it the first time, we got a free retry or something like that. So that was a bonus of being the first to get out of the gate. So, I didn't find it challenging in that sense. I thought it was reasonable. And again, just by following the study guide, or not the study guide, but the reading guide really helped prepare me for it and just focusing on it. So I didn't find it necessarily a challenge. It was probably the waiting was the biggest challenge.
But that's good. There's challenge as in too hard, and there's challenge as in, yes, I've got some room for growth here. So I'm glad it was feasible, right? I think that's important. Yeah. Andrea or Heidi, would you like to add to that?
I would say, the challenge was first just making the commitment of doing it, right? And then saying, okay, I think I saw a question that came forward, how much time do you need to dedicate it? Do you need to take time off? Mm-hmm. I would say that, if you are working in, a capacity where you're working at promoting, equity, diversity, and inclusion in your workplace, the hands-on work experience, that tangible, the skills that you're gaining in your work are as important as obviously the academic piece and the learning and the readings that you're going to do, putting it into practice. I think when you're sitting there doing the exam, you need to think about the academic piece as well as the kind of best practices, right, that you're instilling. And having that confidence going into the exam, recognizing it's all part of the journey. I think the exam was appropriately challenging in terms of making sure you have a bar to obviously create a certification program around it. But I think it's also accessible to practitioners who are doing this work every day, who are passionate about, creating workplaces that are accessible to everyone and creating a place where everyone feels like they belong. And I think, when you go back to the core competencies, I appreciate it could be overwhelming to individuals when they first look and how the depth of knowledge that you need to gain. But Miriam, you said as well, when you're looking at applications, it's really going through that process to recognize that, wow, like I do actually do this work. And maybe it's not as relevant as I thought, but I'm still making an impact in these particular areas. And I think if people actually go through that process, they too will see that they're going to be in a position that maybe they didn't think they would be to achieve their CCIP by just looking at kind of the process at a while they're going through it. Because I remember too, first going to the website and thinking, wow, there's a lot of core competencies here. But once I started breaking it down and going through the process, it felt a lot more attainable.
Thank you, Heidi. Andrea, were you going to add to that? Or yeah, go ahead.
Just well said, Heidi. I think you hit on a lot of the points I'd say. So I'll save space for another question.
Thanks, Andrea. So I see a question here. Is there a way of finding out if anyone on PEI has the CCIP designation? I'd like to point you to the registry online, and this might be a good tool for others as well. Like I mentioned, it's not necessarily exhaustive. Some people might have opted out. Some people have left out some information like location, but you can search, see if anyone is nearby. And if they have added their LinkedIn, I think it's safe enough that you can send them a little message, see if they're available to ask a few questions. So the registry is found on the CCDI website under the little CCIP tab. So we're winding down a little bit. I wanted to ask Marnie, where do you see the CCIP designation going in the future?
Yeah, that's a great question. Well, these are my hopes, my wish list, and so forth, to do more of this, to bring more CCIPs together and really strengthen that network. It's not, it's one thing to have our CCIPs, across the country and doing the amazing work that we do. But, what is the benefit to us in addition to that, the things I spoke to before, the credibility, who we are in the workplace. But it's, really looking at that network amongst each other, that we can learn from each other, support each other. So there has has, you know, needs to be that added benefit of being a CCIP and learning from each other, that we can work together, support each other. It's a lonely work for a lot of us in organizations where we might be the only person like us in that workplace, right? We need to lean on each other and support each other, to have a, you know, just a space that just we can go to connect with each other and share ideas and resources. And, you know, I'm an open book. I'm happy to share any of the work that we're doing. We're not here to compete with each other. We're here to uplift each other and to support each other. So if I had one wish and hope and vision for the CCIP is to strengthen this connection and network of these amazing professionals and friends and colleagues in this work.
Thank you, Marnie. Certainly the DI field continues to evolve, and there's room for the CCIP program to grow as well. I did also want to thank our wonderful panelists. Thank you, Heidi. Thank you, Andrea. Thank you, Marnie. And thank you, Valerie, wherever you headed off to. All right. Well, I'd like to wish everyone a wonderful day, and looking forward to growing our list of CCIP. Thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you. We hope you enjoyed today's presentation. For more information on upcoming events, please visit our website at ccdi.ca.